So hello and good morning again everyone here from Leoben, Montanuniversität in Austria. Welcome back to our online lecture series, Sustainable Development Approaches in Engineering Research and Education, brought to you by the Austrian branch of the International Competence Centre for Mining Engineering Education under the auspices of UNESCO. My name is Anna Boyka. I'm the Communications and Partnership Manager here at the Austrian branch, and I am your guide throughout these lectures. So, coming to today's lecture, we will dive into the fascinating world of the emerging role of robots in mining, which is also our last lecture in the second thematic area, digitalization in mining. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Nikolaus Sifferlinger, Professor for Excavation Engineering here at Montanuniversität Leoben. Before joining our university, he was the leader of the R&D department of automation at Fürstalpine in the 90s and 2000s, where he successfully introduced automation to mining products. Later, he joined the company Sandvik Mining and Constructions in various leading positions and established later on his own business as an independent senior consultant to the global mining, tunneling, and mobile automation industry. In today's presentation, Professor Sifferlinger will give you an overview of the needs for robots in mining, the state of the art in this area, and its implications for teaching and research at our and other universities. Please join me by welcoming Professor Nikolaus Sifferlinger.
Hello everybody, thank you for the nice introduction. Okay, welcome. A few words about myself. You see on the left side here, the picture shows me when I was much younger, 30 years ago, operating a rotator. I was since 1989 in R&D for mining and tunneling equipment. We had a good time. If somebody wants to watch, there's a YouTube video, Dirty Great Machines, where from the minute 21, it also tells you a little bit about the machines I was involved at that time. Since 1st July 2006, I'm a professor of excavation engineering. I also got then conveying technology and design of mobile machines at Montanuniversität Leoben. Few pictures, the dark one on this machine, which is cutting salt. I was responsible 20 years ago for the electrics and the controls, so I know this machine very well. In the beginning, it gave us some troubles. Picture down there shows a concept we developed for a robot for charging explosives in Scandinavia. So I was lucky. I had 27 years in the industry before I joined the university, so I can tell a lot of stories. So if you have any questions, you always can ask. If I don't know, I will tell you. Okay, the underground mining conditions, things are known to us. It's harsh conditions when it comes to temperature, dust, water, but of course also underground always the danger of rock fall or rock burst is there, and no matter what you do in regarding to rock enforcement and support, there's always a risk that something can cave in. So since a long time there are a lot of activities where you want to fully mechanize and then automate the mining process to get out the persons from the areas which are dangerous. We are going more and more into underground mining because on surface the resources are depleted. This is of course more demanding than ventilation, rock support, cooling, transport, and the conditions for human operators in such area are getting worse and worse, and the residual risk for safety grows. I was in a project for Arizona Resolution Mine. It's a copper mine in 3,000 meters depth. The ambient rock temperature there is 80 degrees centigrade. 80 degrees centigrade means if you touch the rock with your hand, you burn yourself. Right? So the deeper we go, the harder it gets. And therefore there is the wish to replace human operators by robots. And the picture here shows a colleague in an Ukrainian coal mine. He's changing pigs on a shearer. It's 1,000 meters below depth. The ventilation was good, but still it was very warm. So that's the reason why he is not wearing any shirt. Also, of course, you shouldn't do that, because if you hurt yourself, it's not good. But if it's so hot, it's just a problem. One advantage of robots, of course, is that they need no ventilation to breathe. So some pictures, one is from the blasting. And then, of course, the toxic blast fumes afterwards. This is the main reason why you have to evacuate, until these toxic nitrogen oxides, the carbon monoxide and cyanide is gone. So what are the reasons for automation and robots in mining? I'm talking now mainly about Europe. Of course, the harsh underground conditions, as he wants me that I watch more into the camera, is that you get more and more or less people who want to work down there, especially qualified personnel. So this is the issue. Reduction of overload and equipment, increasing the efficiency of the operation, sustainable usage of the resources, because if you have robots which can go in where it may be too risky for persons, you can use more of the raw material resources. If you lose a robot, you may have lost, but nowadays the robots, I will come later to, they cost about 75,000 euros. So, okay, you have lost some material, but of course, if you lose a person, you cannot replace it. So the damage to the family, to the society, to the person is unrecoverable. And of course, if you have done wrong, you get punished for this. So this can be millions or billions of euros or dollars, depending what happened. So the idea to have people out of these dangerous places is a long one. Unfortunately, we have not been very successful with that yet, because there's one thing: we have machines which work like robots, but when it comes to install these machines, to repair it, to maintain them, to service them, we still need humans. It's a big issue. So future tasks of robots in mining starts with exploration, of course, roadway development, installation of infrastructure, then production, roof support, selection of ore out of the western side, transport, monitoring hazardous areas, search and rescue, and maintenance and repair. But to be honest, the most important task to replace humans in underground mining is to have robots which can replace the person who is doing work when something gets installed, when you do some repair, when there is a problem. It doesn't help so much. Well, it helps a little bit, but it's not a manless mine. When, like in a long wall, the operation is 98% automatic, but of course, when there is a problem, when there is a hose burst or a cable broken or something stuck, a person has to go in and do it. And also, you have to go in and replace tools and things, cutting tools on a regular basis. And quite often this is in a very dangerous place where you have to do that. So we really urgently need robots which can do maintenance. This is not an easy task, because we have now in the industry, in the car industry, we put together, when everything is prefabricated, we can put together a machine with robots. Humans are just to check and advise. But we don't have robots. For instance, if you have damaged your car, if you drive with your car against a tree and it's heavily damaged, and you come back to the service station, there is no robot who can repair that yet. So repairing is not the easy task, but we need it urgently underground. So when we say, okay, we need that, we must think about one thing. In mining, the whole robot industry, the research and development budgets are very limited. The yearly budget put for new equipment totally is about 150 billion euro in the whole mining, and we have about 1% of R&D in mining. Especially in the last 10 years, everything was cut down. Most important thing in mining is to show the profit. And so with 1.5 billion euros, you're not getting very far when you add all this up. So this is the issue we have. So the mining industry would be never able to get quick to robots for all things which are needed to develop them by themselves. There is an example here, a robot in South Africa. This is an industrial robot which can change rollers on a running conveyor. This is also what we can do, a robot. You can work on equipment which is running, actually, because, again, if the robot gets catched, yeah, he is robust and he will not lose an arm. What we are lucky, or not so lucky, when we see it from the society, of course, we are not so lucky when we spend a lot of money in military for robots. They invest a lot in humanoid robots who can walk, who can do maintenance. They always say they are not built to shoot, but I'm not sure why the Ministry of Defense spends $10 billion. So it's Defense Advanced Research Project Agency, the DARPA, to get robots. They have, of course, in mind robots for fighting. And fighting also, robots for fighting with persons in a field, in a city, and things like that. And the American Army foresees in 10 years that a troop of, which is now 10 persons, will be 4 to 6 persons and 6 robots. 2 robots will carry material, but 4 robots will be able to shoot as well. And these robots are also able to walk and climb and things like that. So if you're interested what these robots can do, you see here the Boston Dynamics mobile robots at the Atlas. It's just amazing what happened in the last 10 years. You can go to the homepage and look at the videos. And this is just these things which they show us. And of course, they always say, nah, we are military, but we are not building this to shoot. Ne? Okay, but there will be offsprings available soon, and this we can also use in mining. And some of these offsprings are already operating in mining. So the Atlas is about as big as I, 1.6 meters. Okay, I'm 1.7 meters, but I'm more than 100 kilos. This robot is just 80 kilos. But okay, after 1 hour he has to charge his battery, so I can go longer. But otherwise, it's really a marvel what this robot can do, how flexible it is. And the other one is the RoboDog, the Spot. And this Spot is already getting into mining for researching dangerous spots. This small robot is about the size of a dog, can carry 14 kilos. Of sensors. And when we talk now in mining and robots, of course we have the industrial robots. The industrial robots usually have a wide weight between 100 kilos and 1 ton. This is these robots you see, which are putting together cars and other things and electronics in factories. We in mining have big machines, the tunnel boring machines you see here on this diagram on the top there, and large trucks, and these tunnel boring machines can be already run automated, and also the trucks can be autonomous. So this big equipment is already a robot, a real robot, because it can work autonomously for a certain time until it needs service. So you have to feed and care for it. Eh? Feed it with parts, oil maybe. So, and then the rover miners, we think this is there in this zone between the red and the green, will be between 0.5 to 5 tons and will be able to fulfill roles which humans are doing at the moment in underground mining. Also, this is a plan, an anticipated evolution of the robot technology in the next 30 years. The source is the Horizon 2020 Robot Miners Consortium, where Leoben is one of the partners. So at the moment we have demonstrators. We do study certain things. We think in 10 years we will have first industrial pilots, semi-automated operation for systems which are really self-dependent. About 2050 there should be robots available which are able to do the work which is necessary underground. 2050. I will be 89 at that time. I don't think I will be 89. So I will not be with you at that time anymore. But of course I will watch as far. I'm 59 now. So I will watch as much as possible. But you are the students. You're at the beginning of your career. You will be in 2050. You are just a little bit younger than I am now. So you will be between 50 and 55. For you, it will be normal. So exciting times for you, and you will be part of it. Good luck. But of course, we try to do as much as possible already from now from in our research teams. When we talk about robots in mining today, there are some exploration robots. This is the underwater UX1. This was designed in a European research project, the Horizon 2020 UNEX Win. This was especially for flooded mines to check what is the condition, what is in there. This is an autonomous vehicle which can go in. If you want to know more, I always have given you the internet addresses of the homepages of these products or projects. Longwall mining. In coal mining, it's working 98% automatic in good condition. So you can steer a longwall from anywhere. This has been shown that there was a longwall in China which was steered from Germany. So it doesn't really matter if you're on site or on the surface. Usually you have your control room on a nice place on surface, but you still need a team of filters and electricians to fix problems. So the way it is that longwall is about 200 meters long, $100 million of equipment, and the operator sits on surface, everything he controls it from there, but when he has a problem and he loses somewhere pressure or electrics, then he has to call his persons down there and say, okay, on shield 75, I lose pressure, I may have a broken hose. Please go there and fix it. So we still need humans to go there. And especially when we do maintenance, there's sometimes a reason why something is broken. Sometimes this reason is a roof fall or so. So this is a dangerous condition. So for this, it would be great if we would have some of these mobile robots to call in, fix things, change parts. Also, I must say, when we have robots, we will have also to change the way how we design machinery, because nowadays we design machinery, and I'm a culprit as well, because I was doing it for 20 years, that only two or three humans can fix something, nearly breaking their fingers when they exchange something. The robot would be invented saying, oh, I need this, or I can use a book, or I can use this screwdriver to get this out somehow. We have to simplify things. Of course, in search and rescue, there are a lot of ideas there. Usually on rubber-tired wheels, sometimes also on tracks. This is fine, however, the wheels and tracks are fine as long as the road is good enough. But if you have a lot of obstacles you need to climb, then these robots fail, they have to stop. So this is really search and rescue, but early prototypes, I must say so. And of course, all the major mining nations doing research in that, so United States, in Europe, Russia, China, but it's too much on the research side yet. It's not really operational equipment. This is interesting. So this is one of the robots from Boss Dynamics and LKAB. This is a big Scandinavian iron ore producer, bought last year such a spot. And the spot has the task to go underground. There are areas, there are 1,300 meters below surface. Sometimes they have rock fall and rock bursts. And afterwards, there's a lot of damage in these openings and tunnelings. So it's too dangerous to send people. So this robot will go in. This robot is at the moment learning the underground situation in Kiruna. And will report back what he has seen. This robot can go for one day. He's able to learn his way. So especially underground, if things are not changing too much, you have the geometry of the tunnels. He can remember that. So he can have his way in and his way out without having communication or having a line where he finds back. Cost about $75,000. This is Nikolaus Sifferlinger. He is the research engineer at LKAB together with the spot. As I said, it is also a long learning curve. So, but you see also the size, how big it is, and it's coming. Also in the United States, they're starting to use these robots also for research and rescue and checking dangerous situations. The most autonomous robots are the trucks. They really drive kilometers underground without any contact to a person. The way how it is done, it's also of course with sensors, and then by learning the geometry of the tunneling system. And there are a couple of hundreds already operating all over the world. Africa, America, Australia, Europe. The down thing of this is, if you have such a robot coming there, it is not allowed to have humans at the same place. That means where you have autonomous vehicles in underground mining, nobody can go in because it's too dangerous. We do not have the means yet to 100% detect persons. We do have proximity detection systems which can see a person around that, but these systems are not fail-safe, so we have to separate robots and humans at the moment in mining. Yeah, this was the Komatsu prototype at the Las Vegas Mining Show in 2016. There is no longer any driver's cabin on, if you see that. In the meantime, there are more than 200 of this type running. Also, Caterpillar is having such equipment. Fortescue is an Australian iron ore miner, was one of the leaders in changing to autonomous trucks in 2012, and so far they have commissioned 137 autonomous trucks in surface operation, which they have driven 33.5 million kilometers without accidents. Of course there have been breakdowns, but no accidents, so they didn't have collisions. Also Caterpillar. So autonomous trucks, both in surface and underground mining, are employed. These are really robots. They know their way, they find the way, but when they are sick, they need help. And there is no help in form of robots yet. It's a fragile human person who's going there and has to change the tires. or do other things and help this big vehicle. Another research robot was in Vamos. This was a rotator type equipment built to brought from a vessel on the surface into flooded mines or areas and then cut material and then transport this material as a slurry to surface. So this is a picture as it was planned. Also a picture, so you see here, this is the vessel with the crane. And down there you can see the rotator shimmering through and then the line where you get your materials to surface. This was built in this project. 27 ton heavy rotator, especially for underwater operation. This is when it was on surface, on the vessel. You see it here, the hose which moved the material, the cutter head, then this loading device, and all everything was on tracks. This is when you was putting it down. And of course, this must be a robot. Interesting, you see a lot of sensoric here, sensors, because you need to distinguish also where you're cutting, what you're cutting. And this was quite an interesting project from the technologies. And this is how the operators were doing that. He had a picture of that. See it. Mainly the machine was automatic when once he had positioned it. So he was monitoring, and out of the sensors you could see what he was cutting, where he was cutting. So quite an interesting project. It was a fully operational mining system for excavation, material and transport, robotic. A prototype was built and tested in England and Ireland. We initially wanted to test it in Bosnia, but just to show you how political conditions are nowadays, our team was threatened that if we are not paying 100,000 euros of protection money, something bad will happen to the team and to the machine. And this is reality, Europe 2018. So the project team decided to do the tests in Ireland and not in Bosnia, because there the mafia is too strong involved in everything. Yo. There's another micro-tunneling prototype, the Badger, which is also doing mapping, tunneling, and detection of objects. When you drill under roads or existing infrastructure. Our research project where we at the moment in is the robo miners should deliver a 1,000 kilo prototype, which should be able to go underground and select the material and also excavate it and then transport it to surface. The robot is sent underground via a borehole using specialist sensing device to detect the ore, using onboard production devices, where this is not so much topic. The more important thing is the sensing devices, and then produce this lorry and pump it out. Interesting concept, this robot will move on screws. So it's not neither climbing nor having tracks or never having wheels. And this is the body where things will do. And then there will be this prototype, which will be ready in 2 years, where you can excavate in front, transport the material. So also onboard diagnosis, saying what type of material is there, and move it backward. It's not so much a production robot, it's more for exploration, of course, because the with such a small machine, you only can get very few tons of material, and usually it's not enough, but you develop the sensors and all the technologies you need to have and get your students ready to the challenge. Cybersecurity is an important issue when we talk about robots, because maybe you have it in the horror movies or so, when somebody is taking over the working machines and then the working machines are going after you. But this is no longer when you have, if this is a robot, if this is an industrial robot, which is mounted fixed in a room, in an industry hall, okay, if he goes berserk, you should not enter his area during his operation anyhow. And if he goes berserk, if you step away him and maybe he can get something and throw after you, but otherwise he can't follow you. But when you have robots, which are like humans who can walk and carry out things, if you reprogram them, they can be lethal weapons. This is something. So security is a big topic. I have just had this thing that in the United States, when the colonial pipeline was taken over by hackers, and there was no piping of petroleum and other things from Texas to the east end of the states for a week, was a devastating attack, and it just showed how real these things are. I must say, here in Austria, I know many companies like Balfinger or Meyer-Wellenhof or Schwing, who have been down for a week because all their data, which you need nowadays to produce and do all the business, were taken over by hackers, encrypted, and I think most of them paid ransom so that they could work again. So I think this is a challenge for all the digitalization. Because if they start to crack into, for instance, our banking system and we get robbed of thousands of dollars and this affects millions of people, this will be no fun. So there is a big task in server security as well. Should not forget this. Whenever we do automation and online diagnosis and changing of programs. Yeah. Space mining is a task for robots. NASA is very active in that. I have a team of students. They participated in a challenge last year, the NASA challenge, where the task was to do the cutting drums out of 150 teams worldwide. They actually became place number 3. So this was quite good. And I have 2 students. One is doing a master thesis on excavation on moon, and one is doing a master thesis on conveying materials on the moon. And so this is a topic which is in research, because there you will have robots, of course. And if we want to go to the moon, it looks like that, it's very important that you recover oxygen and water from the moon, because it's much too expensive to transport this from the Earth to the moon. It's easier than to transport material from the moon back to Earth. But yeah. This is Albert Einstein Memorial in Ulm. He was a very serious guy when he came to work, but he was a funny guy as well. So be the same. Enjoy your work. Be serious about what you do, but have fun.